Oh, come on, give God some praise this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
Hallelujah. We bless God for you this morning.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. 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 We bless God this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank God for all of you this morning.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want to welcome all of our online guests this morning.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We're so excited about being in the house this morning.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So excited this morning. And we just praise God for all that He's continuing to do in the house. Amen. 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 If you've been paying attention, God's been doing some stuff. Amen. You know, listening to Sister Wanda this morning, you know, it's amazing because if you start paying attention, God's doing some stuff in your life.
Yes, He is.
He is doing some stuff. You know, and so many people, you know, your first response when something happens is, you know, you start thinking about what's happening. And you're not thinking about what God is doing.
Amen.
You know, how can I put this? So many people, I hear people all the time talking about, you know, I'm believing God to get out of debt. Well, guess what? You can't believe in God to get out of debt if you didn't have a bill in the first place.
Come on,
man.
You can't believe God for healing if there wasn't sickness in the first place. I believe He said it when, you know, Lazarus, you know, he said, you know, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God. You got to realize some things are happening just so God can show Himself. So you got to recognize that when something's happening, you got to have the right mindset. You got to have the right spirit about it so that you don't get in league with the enemy and make a temporary thing permanent. You know, I was talking to somebody the other day, and y'all have heard me say this before. The Bible says every day ordained for me is written in His book before it came into existence.
Yes.
So if that's the case, then that means that even though it surprised you, it didn't surprise God.
That's right.
And the Bible says that He knows the plans He has for you.
That's right.
Plans for a hope and a future.
Yes.
Plans to prosper you. So plans for your success.
Yes.
So if it didn't surprise Him and He's got a plan for your success, then what are you tripping for?
That's right.
I mean, you got to get your mind right when stuff show up. Like, okay, God, what am I supposed to do?
That's right.
If He tell you be quiet, then be quiet.
That's right.
Come on now.
Amen.
I'm telling you, you're entering into a season where God's going to be doing some stuff.
My God.
And your greatest asset is going to be hearing God.
Yes.
But James tells us you don't want to just be a hearer and deceive yourself.
Amen.
You got to be a hearer and a doer.
Yes.
I don't know who need to hear that this morning, but I'm just trying to tell you, this is where you are because God's doing some amazing things right now. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Well, go ahead and open your, take your Bible in your hand and stand on your feet. And repeat after me. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
I believe every word.
I am.
Who it says I am. I can have. What it says I can have.
I can do.
What it says I can do.
By hearing its word.
And applying it by faith.
It'll change my life.
So I declare right now.
From this day forward.
That my life.
Will never.
Ever.
Ever.
Be the same again.
And neither shall the life.
Of anyone.
With whom.
I share.
This word.
So I declare.
I'm going to share.
This word.
With someone.
So that their life.
May be changed forever.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Give God praise as you take your seats. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Precious God, Lord, we thank you today. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the moments of preaching. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for every opportunity, Lord, to stand before your people and declare your word. Father God, Lord, I ask you, Lord, to move me out of the way. Stand in my place. Father God, declare your gospel. Father God, Lord, we came for revelation. Father God, insight, foresight. Father God, speak from heaven. Father God, that we may hear and obey. Father God, Lord, that we may step into, Father God, Lord, the manifestation of the things, Lord, you've already spoken into existence. Father God, Lord, that we may see, Father God, Lord, that which you already know. And Father God, Lord, we trust you and believe you, Lord, that great things stand before us. So, Father God, Lord, we bind every contrary spirit, every demonic force, anything that would attempt to hinder and discourage, Father God, Lord, and keep us from that which you have us to walk into. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that this is, Father God, Lord, our season. Lord, this is our time, Lord, and we declare victory right now, and we give you praise for everything, Lord, you continue to do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Open your Bibles with me to the book of the Gospel of John, chapter 8. Gospel of John, chapter 8. Now, if you've been with us, then you know that 2020 is the year of great change. I told you this year we're going to see the transfer of power. The transfer of wealth, and we're going to experience great freedom because God wants to put us in the positions of influence to advance his kingdom. Just like he said to the Israelites, he's going to drive out all of the nations from before you, and you will dispossess greater and mightier nations than yourselves. And it has nothing to do with you, your ability, or your background. It's all because of his grace. But if we're going to expand the kingdom and give birth to the promise God has placed within us, is going to require next level character.
Yes.
So we've been talking about the process of character development. Because the Bible says all of creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. In other words, they're looking for someone that looks like him.
Yes.
Someone who has his character. But the problem is too many times when they look at the church, it looks just like the world. What do you mean, Pastor? We're just as broke as they are. Our marriages are tore up. Our kids are out of control. Simply because we have not developed his character. Are y'all in John chapter 8?
Amen.
Look at verse 31. Here it says, then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word. Now notice he's talking to believers. He said, if you abide in my word. The King James Version says, if you continue or remain consistent. He said, you are my disciples indeed. One who has not only received instruction, but who has also applied what they've learned. See, the Bible says no student is above his teacher, but when properly trained, he'll be just like his teacher.
Amen.
So what Jesus is saying here, that if we develop a consistent habit of obedience to his word, we will have the ability to demonstrate his character.
Yeah.
He goes on to say in verse 32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. See, what separates us from the rest of the world is our ability to not only recognize truth, but utilize it to break free from the bondage of the enemy. And being consistent in the word is what produces the intimate knowledge and greater understanding necessary to apply it in every situation. See, most people have heard word or at least been exposed to it, but very few can actually apply it. And that's because they fail to be consistent. See, the reason why most people come to church is because they have a problem. But oftentimes when things get better, they stop coming. So they continue to struggle. And that's why I told you on last Sunday, it's important to develop a consistent habit of obedience. As a matter of fact, God said through Moses, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, all these blessings would come upon you and overtake you. So if we want to experience the blessings of God, we've got to shift our habits. Because I told you, your character is determined by your habits, and your habits are determined by your behavior. Well, I like to define character as the sum total of your unconscious behavior. It's the result of your consistent habits. In other words, it's your default setting. Tell your neighbor, it's your default setting.
It's your default setting.
See, your character is who you are when nobody's looking. You know, when the cameras are off, when you're tired, when you're in pain, when you get bad news. But the problem is, many believers still have an ungodly character. Oh, y'all ain't got to say amen. What do you mean, Pastor? Sure, they go to church on Sunday, but because they never change their environment, their thinking, their speech, their behavior, or their habits, their character never changed. And when problems show up, we see who they really are. When somebody cuts you off in traffic, when you stub your toe, when you get an unexpected bill, when you get the wrong diagnosis. So this morning I want to talk to you about how to flip that switch. How to change your default setting. Is that all right?
Amen.
Go over to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, and when you get there, look at verse 6. Paul puts it this way: as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. In other words, if you've accepted Christ, then demonstrate his character. Mm-hmm. See, I used to think maybe I was asking too much, but here Paul thinks the same thing. Evidently, ain't nothing wrong with expecting believers to act like believers. Yeah, I'm going to just pause right there for a minute. See, maybe I used to think something was wrong with me when I would see church folk acting like world folk, and I thought something was wrong with it. See, but here Paul says, as therefore you have received Christ the Lord, so walk in him.
Amen.
He says that's the expectation. If you say Jesus is your Lord, then you ought to act like it.
Amen.
You should demonstrate Christ-like character. He says rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught. Oh, wait a minute, Pastor. I think you own to something. Maybe that's the problem. They haven't been taught. He says, abounding in it with thanksgiving. See, our character should be firmly planted and developed in the word. Secured by our trust in what he said, regardless of what we encounter. See, no matter what happens, my default setting should be what the word says.
Yes, yes.
No matter what problem shows up, I shouldn't look like everybody else.
That's right.
I should look like what the word says.
Amen. Amen.
But Pastor, you don't understand. No, you don't understand. James said, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. He says, when you have various trials. He says, when problems show up, he said, count it joy. That don't even make sense. It don't have to make sense. See, because watch this. When it's your default setting, you don't even process it. I need you to understand this. I'm going to have to go a little technical for you to understand this. See, there are certain things in a computer that process based on the input. You know, you give it certain input and then it does what you tell it. But there are certain things that it's set to default. When you push the button on the computer, the screen just comes up. Yeah. It's not waiting for you to tell the screen to come up. That's the default setting. It automatically loads up Windows. Yeah. It's not waiting for you to tell Windows to load. Right. See, because that's the default setting. It's not even asking you. It's not thinking about anything. It's just doing what it automatically is supposed to do. It doesn't have to make sense. See, it doesn't automatically start printing. It doesn't automatically open up Word. It doesn't automatically start typing a letter. See, because it has to process that information in order to do that. But it automatically opens up the operating system because that's the default. James tells you, when you fall into a problem, your default setting ought to be joy. So it ain't got to make sense. See, if you have God character, your default setting ought to be no matter what happens, my response is what the word says. See, but the problem is, if you have not established God character as your default, you respond, watch this. Somebody disrespect me, I got to deal with it. See, because that's your default. But the Bible says, pray for those.
Yes, that's
right. That's what the Bible says.
Yes, yes.
Bless those who curse you. That's what the Bible says. Your default is they curse me, they going to get it. You got to flip that switch.
Yes.
So I told you, our character has to be firmly planted, developed in the word, secured by our trust in what he said, regardless of what you encounter. Notice what he says in verse 8, but beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit. In other words, foolish thinking. Foolish theories. You can't let nobody get away with disrespecting you. That's somebody else's philosophy. That ain't what God said. Watch this. If that were the case, what do you think would have happened to the man who spit on Jesus on the cross? He already told you he had legions of angels at his disposal. What do you think would have happened if you would have spit on me and I had legions? If you can't let nobody disrespect you. But see, he says, beware lest you let somebody cheat you. With empty deceit, according to the traditions of men. He said, see, I ain't going to let you cheat me. See, that's what God's character look like. He says, according to the basic principles of the world. and not according to Christ. In other words, don't let anybody take advantage of you by getting you to believe something that is contrary to the word. See, every form of bondage is based on a way of thinking that is contrary to the word. See, I know people who say, well, you know, I got anger issues. No, you ain't got anger issues. You got a problem with submitting to God.
That's right.
Amen.
See, because anger is not an issue if you're submitted.
Right.
Well, trust me, I know, because I used to have them. But once I submitted, I don't have a problem with anger. Because the Bible tells me be angry but sin not.
That's right.
So I can get upset, but I know what to do with it.
That's right.
I know how to handle it. See, the only reason you got an anger issue is because you don't know what to do with it. See, because you're holding on to offense. You're holding on to hurt. But the Bible says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper.
Come on, man.
So if I believe him, how am I going to be mad with you?
Come on.
See, the only reason I can be mad with you is if I actually thought what you did could hurt me. Watch this. Y'all ever seen like, you know, like one of these three-year-olds, you know, one of these kids that have not been properly disciplined and they coming up to you and they trying to hit you? Can you be mad with them? They three. They can't hurt you. They might be an annoyance, but you can't get mad with them because they don't have the ability to actually injure you. You look crazy trying to fight them. What you mad for? So if nothing you can do can hurt me, then what I'm mad with you for? So if I actually believe him, then I can't be mad with you.
Right.
But see, because you've been led away, deceived, cheated by vain philosophy, by empty deceit, now you're walking around with an anger issue.
Yeah.
And now you've held on to that anger to the point now you've got to do something. Now you're walking in sin.
Mm-hmm.
See, every form of bondage is based on a way of thinking that's contrary to the word. Example, poverty, abuse, addiction. And the reason why it's so difficult for people to get free of these conditions is because they believe they were meant to be in them. Well, you know, this, everybody in my family, alcoholic. You know, everybody, you know, we just grew up poor. You know, this is where I come from. We from the hood. And? That's what you say. God said I came from him. So I ain't from no hood. I'm from heaven. Some of y'all missed that. I don't care what your mom and daddy's address was.
That's right.
Amen.
Watch this. You get a lot of mail every day. Just because you got it out of the mailbox don't mean that's where it came from. Somebody gonna get that in the car. See, just because your mom and daddy's address may have been the projects, don't mean that's where you from. That package originated from heaven.
Amen.
The projects just happen to be the mailbox that you got picked up out of. See, you believe that you were meant to be in those situations. You've accepted those situations as normal. But here Paul tells us, for in him dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Amen. Amen.
In him, in the word, dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Of God's character exists in the word. Everything that God is exists in the word.
Amen.
Yeah, I wish you could wrap your mind around that concept. It's a wonder your coffee table can stand up under the weight. Everything that has created the entire universe and holding it in place is sitting on your coffee table. It exists in that word. And you are complete in him. Watch this. That word complete means nothing lacking, nothing wanting. So watch this. You're incomplete, but you're complete in the word.
Amen.
I see people, if you watch most people, the reason why they do drugs, alcohol, promiscuous and sexual activities, all of these things, the reason why their lives are that way is because they're trying to fill a void.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because something's missing.
Uh-huh.
Well, he says you're complete in him.
Amen.
The missing piece is the word.
Amen.
I just feel like something's missing in my life. It's the word.
Right.
It's got every answer to every problem, every solution, because the totality of God's character exists in the word. And the Bible says, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. So you were created to exist with his character.
Amen.
But when man sinned, we lost it. So now there's a hole there. And you've been trying to fill it with the world's character and it don't fit. Square peg, round hole. If you ever seen a square peg in a round hole, there's still some gaps there. And that's why you can only fill it with the word. You got to get this. See, that's why it's so disturbing for me as a pastor to see people struggle, especially believers, because everything they need is contained in the word. The very character of God that literally created the entire world, that has the ability to change the world, but in order to flip that switch and become a true disciple, as God intended, we must submit to the word. Go over to Colossians chapter 1. Am I helping anybody?
Yeah.
Amen. See, you watch people. They get money and they still ain't happy. They get a relationship and they still ain't happy.
Mm-hmm.
It's because there's something missing.
That's right.
See, when you have the character of God, there's nothing ever missing.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing ever missing. When my bank account's empty, ain't nothing missing. Y'all still ain't there? I told y'all last week, y'all remember Joseph, right?
Yeah.
The boy was in a pit, but won't nothing miss him. Because God was with him.
Amen.
Watch this. How you going to be missing when you got somebody who got everything? I used to be slow too. How you gonna be missing something when you with somebody who got everything? See, when I was in the street, we used to hang out, and if Dennis was broke when we was hanging, I'm like, Dennis, I ain't got no money. Come on, we good. Cause if I got, you got. So if I was broke this week and then his head looked, he'd be like, yo, come on, we good.
That's right.
Because if he got, I got.
Yeah.
Well, if me and Dennis could roll like that, if I'm with God and he got everything.
Yes. My God. Amen.
What could be missing?
That's right. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Y'all in Colossians 1?
Mm-hmm.
He says here in verse 9, he says, for this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. In other words, it's our prayer that you recognize how vital the word is to your life and that you would make a commitment to receiving it on a regular basis. Look at verse 10. He says that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. So that you can demonstrate his character, increasing as you continue to gain an understanding of who he is. See, the more time you spend in his word, the more you'll understand how much he loves you.
Amen.
And the more you'll reflect that love in the earth.
Yes.
Which will impact your marriage, your finances, your health, your community, your home.
Right.
See, God desires that his children and their character be a reflection of his word.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, go over to Romans chapter 12. Look at verse 2. He says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. In other words, stop emulating the world's character.
Amen.
He says, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yes.
Tell your neighbor, flip the switch.
Flip the switch.
He said, then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will.
Yes.
See, that's why Jesus gave us the word.
Yes.
Because the word is the only thing that can shift our thinking. And as a believer, our character should be determined by our total submission to God's word.
Yeah.
To the point that we've developed a consistent pattern of unconscious obedience. What do you mean, Pastor? Let me help you. Have you ever called somebody and said something to them and they said, you don't know how much I really needed that.
Amen.
And then you said, I don't even know why I called you. But you were in my spirit. See, that's because it's starting to become your default setting. See, because when you have the character of God, when you hear his voice, you just do what he said without thinking about it. See, I don't need to know why I'm supposed to call you. I don't even know what I'm supposed to call you for. I just pick up the phone and call. Because I heard something say call. I don't even know why I'm saying what I say. I just say it because he said say it. That's my default setting. My default setting is absolute total submission to the word of God. I am totally submitted to his word, to his spirit. So anything he says to me, I just do. Go to 2 Peter chapter 1. I'm telling you, it has to become your default setting. Y'all were listening to Sister Juana's testimony, and I was just bugging. Because in a couple of weeks, God, I can't tell you right now. But I was having a conversation earlier this week. One of those kind of conversations where I just said something. I asked a question because God told me to ask. I ain't know why I asked. We weren't even talking about anything on this particular subject. It was just what he told me to ask. And when I asked the question, the answer came back. Didn't line up with anything that I asked. But it led to me to ask more questions. And I found out something that nobody knew but God. But it has led me down a road for God to do some stuff that's going to blow everybody's mind. And I'm like, I thank God that this is my default setting. And everybody else is too. Because it's like, if you hadn't,
this would have spelled certain disaster. But now we're going to see the hand of God simply because it's just my default setting. See, we don't, I told you, God is doing stuff. He is speaking now. I need you to understand how important it is. Whatever you got to do to maintain peace in your house. Maintain peace in your house. Maintain peace in your life. You don't have time for foolishness. When God was getting ready to destroy the world, he spoke to Noah. When he was getting ready to destroy Sodom, he told Abraham, what if they had a bunch of mess going on and they ain't here? See, this is the thing. You cannot be caught up in mess. And you can't hear God. Your family, your children, your future, your blessing is going to be determined by your ability to hear and obey God. Some of y'all, I know the kids don't even know what this is. Y'all remember when you used to have a house phone? And there was no such thing as call waiting.
Yes.
And your mama used to tell you, get off that phone, I'm expecting a phone call.
Yes. Yes.
See, you couldn't tap the line
because
they were expecting to hear from somebody.
Yes. Yes.
Y'all gonna catch this in a minute. See, you can't tie up the line with foolishness.
Yes.
That's why you can't walk in unforgiveness. In offense, you can't have stress in your life because you can't tie off the line. You ought to always be expecting to hear from God. God trying to tell you how to get your healing and you sitting there dealing with foolishness. I ain't got time for that, man. I'm expecting a phone call. Because God's trying to do some stuff. Mm-hmm. Truth is, he already has done some stuff. He's trying to tell you how to get to it. Second Peter chapter 1. Look at verse 2. He says, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. See, the more words you get, the more grace and peace you get. The more unmerited favor and shalom you're able to obtain. Because the better you understand who he is, the better you can reflect his character. Verse 3 says, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Notice he said that everything that you need to be like God or to demonstrate his character and to live the life that he intended for you to live, God has already given to you. Notice, he's not going to give, but he's already given. Well, if that's the case, then where is it? He said his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who has called us by his glory and virtue, by which he has given to us exceedingly great and precious promises. In other words, everything will be released as you get to know the word. Because if you don't know the promises, you may miss out on something God has already given you. See, you can be broke, sick, lonely, but it's not because God has not given you what you needed. It's because you don't know what you've been promised. So you can't get what he has for you. Tell your neighbor, you got to get the word. It says that through these, you may be partakers of the divine nature. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. See, that word is the word that allows you to partake of his character. And it's the corruption that is in the world that comes from lust. The evil desire for things that you want or lack. But Paul said we are complete in him. I told you that word complete means nothing lacking, nothing wanting. But the problem is, if we don't know the word, we can't reflect his character. You'll never know what you have. That's why Jesus said, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. See, he said, unless you abide in the word and the word's in you, you won't produce anything. You'll never look like him. He said, I'm the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. See, the reason why most people are not consistent is because they underestimate the value of the word. See, when they have problems, it's urgent. But when things get better, it's optional. But if you're going to demonstrate his character, you got to continue in the word. Amen. Go over to Philippians chapter 2, last scripture. I'm trying to teach you how to flip the switch. Because I'm so sick of seeing believers that don't look like believers. Amen. Don't live like believers. Don't think like believers. Philippians 2, verse 1, he said, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, any fellowship with the Spirit, any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. He said, in other words, demonstrate his character. Amen. He said, do nothing out of selfish ambition, vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also the interests of others. Amen. He said, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped or held on to. See, even though he was in the very nature God, he didn't think that was even something that he needed to hold on to. He didn't give it a second thought because submission was his default setting. Because when God said, I need somebody to go, he said, cool. All he said was, yes, sir. Watch this. I'm going to help you get that. Kaya turned 20 a couple of weeks ago. But when I tell her to do something, her answer is still, yes, sir. You got to get it. You got to get it. See, as some folk would say, you ain't got to do what your daddy said. You grown. You an adult like he is. They could have said the same thing to Jesus. But Jesus said he didn't even think his grown was even something worth trying to hold on to. Because submission was his default setting. Amen. See, because I already told you the blessing is in your obedience. Right. See, yeah, he could have held on to his groan, but he would have missed out on something. Yes. The fact that I'm grown like God grown don't matter. Mm-hmm. He told me to do something. And my default setting is whatever he tells me to do.
That's right.
See, watch this. God gave you a free will.
Yes.
So guess what? You grown like he grown. Mm. You ain't got to do nothing he tell you to do. Did you say that, Tessa? Yes, I did. You ain't got to do nothing, God said. But he said, if you've got any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, any fellowship with his spirit, any tenderness and compassion, he said, it make my joy complete by being like-minded. Having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. He said, do nothing out of selfish ambition and vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each one should not look only to his own interests, but also the interests of others. He said, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ, who being in the very nature God. Did I not tell you, did not the Bible say that ye are gods? He said, so being in the very nature gods, don't consider your equality with God something to be grasped or held on to. So even though you're grown just like God is, even though he made you a God just like himself, he said you don't need to hold on to that. Your default setting ought to be total submission, consistent, unconscious obedience. To the point that whatever he says, I just automatically do. I don't even have to think about it. Look at what he says. He didn't give it a second thought. But he made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Tell your neighbor, flip that switch. Say he gave him a name that was greater than every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue confess. See, because he submitted himself, God glorified him. See, you got to develop a consistent habit of obedience to the point where your character is a demonstration of Christ. Because you submit yourself under God's word without thinking. Amen. God bless you today. I'm telling you, if you're going to step into the things that God has prepared, the things that God is releasing in this time, it's going to require an entirely different level of obedience. Amen. I'm going to tell you, the believer that's always, I don't know why we got to do all that. Huh? They ain't gonna see none of this. Hate to tell y'all, but you ain't gonna get there. I don't think it take all that, but guess what? It don't for you. But you ain't gonna get all that either. Amen. Because to get all that, it take all that.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm telling you, you gotta be in the place where when God says it, that settles it.
Yeah.
God ain't got to do nothing but blink in my direction.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir. I'm going to tell you, I can't even describe where I am right now. I find myself doing stuff that ain't even, I mean, out of character for me. It's unconscious. It's out of character for me. My wife would tell you, it's out of character for me. I just find myself in a place where I'm just, whatever God say do, I'm just doing. Amen. I don't even think about it. And the thing about it is, because of that, blessings are overtaking me. They're not only following me, but they're overtaking me.
Yeah.
The last thing on my mind is me. because of that, God's got all that covered. Mm. It's got to become your default setting.
Amen.
When you open your eyes, God, what you want me to do? It ain't got to be fun. You ain't got to like it. I'm so past liking stuff, it don't matter. I'm telling you. This is about total submission. Because that's the character of Christ.
Yes.
See, we try to paint this picture of Christ as, you know, like this was a fun job, man. You saw it. In the garden, he didn't want to do that. He was hot with his boys. Y'all can't even hang out for moral support. Y'all ain't got to go. But I've been feeding y'all jokers, been taking care of y'all, and y'all can't even hang out with a brother before we go? Come on. Y'all can't even pray for him? Y'all know this wasn't no fun journey for him. But he went.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Won't think about it.
Yeah, thank you, Jesus.
Because his default setting was, that's what he said, that's what I'm going to do. We got to get to that place.
Right.
And when you get to that place, I'm telling you, you're going to step into some stuff that you never even imagined. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I want to pray with our internet congregation. If you've never experienced God on this level, if you just want to receive Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, if you want to become a part of God's family, the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe with your heart that God raised him from the dead, you could be saved. The first step is just believing that God loved you enough to give up his son for you. The Bible tells us that the penalty of sin is death. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory. I don't care what it is you've done. I don't care how little you think it is. Trust me. At the moment that you chose to do what you wanted instead of what God said, you were worthy of the death penalty. But God loved you enough to send his only begotten son, his most precious and prized possession, to die on your behalf. And all you got to do is accept the offer. And he'll take your place. But the exchange for that, the price for that, is you have to give up your life in exchange for the new life he wants to give you. You may be thinking that's a hard decision, but that's not even hard because you're not happy with the life you have. If you were, you wouldn't be trying to make a decision. Trust me, this life is better. So pray this prayer with me. Precious God, come into my heart. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I believe that your son died for me. I want to make him Lord of my life. Be my father. Make me your child. Teach me how to live for you. If you prayed that prayer, you're now part of the body of believers, the family of Christ. And there's nothing anybody else can do to stop you. The next step in your journey is to find a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church that will teach you how to live for him. And if you're in the Lynchburg area, we'd love to have you here at My Church Lynchburg every Sunday morning at 11:30 a.m., every Thursday evening at 7 p.m. If you're not in this area, click the link attached to this video. Send us a message. Let us know that you received Christ today, and we'll be glad to help you find a church in your area. If you've just been blessed by this message, and you want to help us continue to spread the gospel all over the world, click the donate button, sow a financial seed, whatever the Lord puts in your heart, and just help us continue to spread the gospel. But in any event, share this message with someone. Let them know how you watched, but share it with somebody who you know needs it. Obey the voice of God. God bless you, and we'll see you again on next week. Amen.
Amen.